Good morning. My name is Joe Keith. I'm the pastor here. We're very glad to join us this morning today. These guys are going to decide. We'll just get over there before I say anything about Justice Ballinger. He's here with friend Caitlin and his help on the staff on the drums. He's been on our campus many times. I'm going to call Cindy Miller. Cindy is the chair of our staff affairs relations committee and of HR in the United Methodist Church, and she's got an announcement about the future.
Good morning. I'm happy to be here earlier than expected. We had shared a few weeks ago that we hoped to know what our new minister would be by mid or May. Well, we know today, and I will share that. Received a call from the district superintendent around this week, and want to share that we will be getting Reverend Gene Aiken as our minister. He is currently serving the Anderson District at Mount Zion and Central United Methodist Churches. He has been there for 4 years, and he will be coming to Memorial with his wife, Katie, and his two daughters, Anne and Michelle, who is 9 years old, and Lily, who is 5 years old. Reverend Howe just was very excited about this appointment for us, and I don't have a whole lot of information yet. SBRC will be meeting with Reverend Aiken and his family this week, so we'll know a little bit more after this week, after the meeting. And I just want to thank all of you for your support, for your prayers during this time. I want to ask for your continued prayer for this congregation, Reverend Kate and his family who we love. And now I want you to add Reverend Aiken and his family as we go through this transition. As always, don't hesitate to contact me. Not sure I'll have a lot of answers right now, but you're always welcome to ask or to contact me anytime. So, thank you. Now we call Red River folks up. Y'all will come on forward. Red River mission folks are leaving now. Right? We have time to serve right back along. And they're heading up to Kentucky to work in a community that they worked in before, that we have specific tasks and mission that we need to replace somewhere on our home. And so we got some handy guys, we got some
funny guys. We've got some helpful guys. And we're going to pray for them in their departure. So y'all pray for me. Y'all one hand out loud and the other. Yeah. Gracious and loving God, we thank you for these men and their willingness to go and serve. Give them safe travel. Give them great fellowship and the opportunity to learn in mission. High school graduates, we're going to celebrate you, every graduate, we're going to celebrate you in the 11 o'clock service next week. We always know the people that we know, but if there's somebody that's connected to our church, that's connected to you, and we need to know that, you need to tell us. We need your help in making the net as big as it can be and those holes as small as they can be. Our youngest Sunday school class, Stepping Stones, has a mission project coming up. Guess how you can support them? Eating biscuits. Who doesn't like to eat biscuits, right? I would love to support mission by eating biscuits every day, right? So please note that in the panel and the things that are coming up. Today is the last Sunday night programming for children, youth, and adults. Now open your bulletin to the five practices. I want you to look at the floral ministry team under mission and service. This is a completely unique thing that has not been ever or for some time. You think, I'm not traveling to Kentucky. Can't put a screen door on. I can't work here and change out a door handle on a door. I cannot do it. Don't have me do any electrical. What if you helped arrange flowers that went to people who couldn't attend very often in our worship service? And people got a flower arrangement delivered to their home. Heather Whitehead is a new member here, about to be a member here, Heather and Robert, and it's their calling mission. She's a board certified, she's a master gardener. That is not something we share. So she's a master gardener, she loves flowers, and she's going to meet with folks at this white table right here. If you want to stay after worship and learn about that, you say, I can't arrange flowers, you might can deliver flowers. You say, yeah, I can do that. So if you're interested in any of that, make sure that you let us know. We got a lot going on. It's the end of the program year. A lot of news. Please pay attention and see opportunities that are coming up for you. Let's pray together. Gracious and loving God, we thank you for the diversity within our family of interest, experience, age, opportunity, opinion. For people going 100 different directions from this place today to serve you, we're grateful that we're here in this moment to learn from you, to be energized by you, to encourage one another. Use every element in this service, Lord, especially as we gather around the table, to help us know your loving grace that goes before any action. Inspire us as we pray the prayer your Son taught his disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom. kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. Our opening word today is spectators. If you like to fill in blanks like I do, keep track of something as you're paying attention to it, you can look under Passionate Worship in the bulletin and fill these in. How smart are spectators? In any, whatever it is. If you're going to hear a strings concert in middle school, if you're going to a baseball game at Fluor Field, if you are watching a political debate and the convoluted topics that they are discussing, how much do you know about what that person is trying to do and what they're capable of? Let's look at a picture for the day. Kentucky Derby yesterday. All kinds of looks, all kinds of hats. You think the people who were wearing those things and obsessed about what they were wearing knew more about what they were wearing or more about horses? What do you think they knew about the horses? Like, I think they're going to go that way. Right? And everybody says that this is the guy. Right? Everybody says when it's raining, this is the guy. When it's, I can't make up anything because I don't know anything. I don't know anything about horse racing. If I were there, I would just say, tell me, expert, what you know about horse racing. There's a select few in that crowd that have dedicated their lives to understanding this very horse and that very horse and the things that have to happen in order for this to happen. And then there's an ocean of people who are just kind of taking it in, going, oh, it's kind of interesting. I think this is what happened. I have no idea. I want you to have that in mind as we read the text for today, Acts chapter 14, verse 8. In Lystra, there was a man who was lame. He had been that way from birth and had never walked. He listened to Paul as he was speaking. Paul looked directly at him, saw that he had faith to be healed, and called out, "Stand up on your feet." At that, the man jumped up and began to walk. When the crowd saw what Paul had done, they shouted in the Lycaonian language, "The gods have come down to us in human form." Barnabas they called Zeus, Paul they called Hermes, because he was the chief speaker. The priest of Zeus, whose temple was just outside the city, brought bulls and wreaths to the city gates because he and the crowd wanted to offer sacrifices to them. Says your next fill in the blank, the gods have come down. I like to think about this priest who had like a normal day going. He had like three tasks that he had to handle. He had two people that popped in. And he was thinking, okay, how am I going to do this? And oh yeah, there was that thing from last week. And then there was gods in our town. And he's got to get some bulls. He's got to get some whatever to take out on that town sacrifice. He's going insane. His head's spinning going out there. Because there are these people in the community representing the God that I believe in. That's a random day. You know, Monday has a different sort of random feel to us. Tuesday has a random feel. Wednesday has a random feel. Thursday has a crazy random feel around here. We never know which way it's going to go. But two people in the community who have healed a person on the level that someone thinks they're the gods that we worship. That's pretty random. Now, if you played, there's a game that can go any number of different ways. Let's do the G or PG rated version in this room. When you say, would you rather? It's a great conversation starter. When you're driving down the road, you got 4 hours. It can be a positive version or it can be a negative version. You can have two tickets to the Masters for life if you're willing to get hit by a golf ball and you don't know when. Would you do it or not? How many people would do it? I might do it. You know, you don't know when it's going to be that day. You can go any day you want. You're just going to get hit with a golf ball that day. You say, okay, would you rather eat something that's horrible or eat something that you love the next 27 meals that you have? You know, which one of those would you rather do? Something horrible one time or the thing you love 27 straight times? You can do that. I can come up with 1,000 of those for you. But this is the would you rather I want you to think about in terms of this text. Would you rather say to people who are believers in our uppercase G God, we are the faithful people who are bringing this word to you, and they want to stone you? Or go to a community where they think you are people from God, but not the God that you want to represent. Totally confused. And they think, this is Zeus and Hermes. Which one would you rather do as a traveling salesman? Encounter someone that knows exactly who you are, that's rejecting you, or loves you and has no idea what your product is? Neither one would be easy. Neither one would be fun, but to have these people lift you up and say, these are the people that have been sent down from God in order to be here, but for the wrong reason. Verse 14 says, but when the apostles Barnabas and Paul heard of this, they tore their clothes and rushed out into the crowd shouting, friends, why are you doing this? We too are only human, like you. We are bringing you good news, telling you to turn from those worthless things to the living God who made the heavens and earth and the sea and everything in them. Now, what do you think a crowd thinks of you telling them that they're dumb and the thing that they're worshiping in you is worthless and they're flat wrong and you're supposed to worship the big G God that you're trying to tell them about? Be a challenge. If you've ever tried to communicate to a crowd of any size who is struggling to pay attention to you and retain, you understand how difficult it can be in that situation. So that's your next fill in the blank. We're only human. People think the gods have come down because you healed this man, and they say, no, we're only human, and we have nothing to do with those gods, and we have to do with this God. Here's the question. Could they listen to someone that was simply like them? Do you have to do something superhuman, out of control, totally out of the ordinary for me to have anything to do with you? Or can you be a simple human and I pay attention to the message that you're trying to give me? Well, if you blaze through the Gospels, are they more simple, everyday human things? Or are they more supernatural, crazy, somebody was healed things? Somebody was fed things? Time and time again, we humans need something superhuman in order to pay attention. And if somebody gives us a glimpse of it, we put them on this pedestal, and we put them on this pedestal, and then we put them on this pedestal. And by the time we put them on this pedestal, we go, I'm kind of tired of this guy. Why don't somebody else come along that we can rip this guy off this pedestal and you know, put somebody on this, you know, and move people up? When he says we're only human, he undercuts the biggest value that they have for people to pay attention to them. But it's the thing that they've absolutely got to do to convey that this God doesn't operate the way that you think a God should. We are the simple. We are the ordinary. We are the bearers of the word that is God's. He says we're only human. Verse 16 says, in the past, he let all nations go their own way. Yet he has not left himself without testimony. This he is God. He has shown kindness by giving you rain from heaven and crops in their seasons. He provides you with plenty of food and fills your heart with joy. Even with these words, they had difficulty keeping the crowd from sacrificing to them. So that's your next blank, is the pedestal. We love it. We love placing people on it, and we love tearing people off of it. We love climbing on it, and we'll do anything to stay on it. That pedestal is a very powerful thing. You say, no, 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 no. we're not the gods of Zeus and Hermes. And they go, So anyway, we're here to sacrifice to Zeus and Hermes. And what's the significance of humans being here representing Zeus and Hermes? It's the equal significance to someone that you desperately need an answer to, not being four steps away on a phone tree, but being right here, right in front of you. I can ask you, not be on hold for 5-10 years. I can ask you right in front of me. That's why I'm going to make this sacrifice to you, Hermes. So that what? I'm going to make this sacrifice to these two people who represent the God I believe in, so that what? The community will be blessed. People will know the love of God, and we'll all live in harmony. Just kidding. No. So I can get what I want. I will knock this fool out of the way so that I can sacrifice to you, because you're here in human form, so that I can get what I want. Think about the questions that were posed to Jesus with this in mind. Do I get to sit beside you? Do I get to sit beside you in heaven? Can you heal my nephew? I'm hungry. I'm tired. Can we stay here? Can we get out of here? Whatever it is, think about that human nature to do that and to want the tangible in order to get what you want. The Bible is full of stories of leaders fighting people off. And those biblical leaders throughout the entire book have to make a choice about whether it's about God or whether it's about them. What would you say the batting average of those folks is? About like a solid batting average in baseball, maybe 333. Them saying, this isn't about me, this is about God. When they take that powerful position, when they wrangle humans to get what they want, then those leaders fail, the nations fail, everything fails, and then you have to call up a new leader. Think about what these guys did. Guys who didn't have a proven track record before they were given another chance. They walked into this town, they healed this man who had only known that infirmity and been defined by that infirmity in his community, I'm guessing. And then when everyone wanted to give them credit, they said, no, that's not us. Even though they're fighting that, spectators are kind of clueless, kind of struggling to pay attention, kind of thinking about the thing that they want and they need right this second. And if leaders with those spectators choose God, then they have to communicate that the way these guys did. So here's your final question. What do spectators think of me? See, there's people here who are dedicated here, and when we come here, we all hold it together, mostly. And we try to do our very best to have our best face on and do what we're going to do. When we go out there and somebody doesn't know you, do you behave better or do you behave worse if nobody knows you? If that spectator knows that you have anything to do with God, what do they think of you, given their ignorance, given their mild lack of focus, and given them things that you've told them through your actions and your words? That's what you got to ask yourself as you're coming to the table, as you go back for a time of silent prayer and reflection, as you leave this place, and people will watch you for the rest of the week. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. If y'all stand as you're able. In this worship service, we affirm our faith with the modern affirmation. You're welcome to join us, and you're welcome to simply listen. We believe in God the Father, infinite in wisdom, power, and love, whose mercy is over all his works, and whose will is directed to his children's good. We believe in Jesus Christ, Son of God and Son of man, the gift of the Father's unfailing grace, the ground of our hope, and the promise of God fulfilled. We believe in the Holy Spirit as the divine presence in our lives, reminding us always of the truth of Christ, our inspiration and strength in times of joy and sorrow. We believe our faith should be apparent,
in our words of love and acts of service, that the kingdom of God may be a present reality here on earth. You may be seated. So once a month, we read that modern affirmation, and directly following it, we have the confession and pardon around the table as part of the liturgy of the United Methodist Church. You just read it, what we're hoping to do. I want you now to read what we struggle to do, okay? I want you to join with me in the liturgy for Holy Communion, and if you'll read the bold. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We've broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We either lost focus with God or we thought somebody wasn't worth it. That's it, really. We lose focus with what God is asking, or we look across at a person and we go, not worth it. Admitting individually and corporately that we have struggled is so critical. Equally as critical is it is offering one another forgiveness in an earnest and sincere way. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. That weight of that struggle of doing what we've been called to do sometimes builds up so much that we don't even want to go out. It's just dragging on us. Let it go. Learn from it. Move on. Come to the table. Be ready to serve as you go forth. It's now time for our offering. And you can give as the plate goes by. If these sections will hand off to one another and make sure a row in front of you isn't skipped. You can also give electronically with instructions in the bulletin. We know that not every family is prepared and ready to give. When you are, we will be grateful to receive it.
I was lost, I was in chains, the world had a hold on me. My heart was a stone, was covered in shame, when he came for me. I couldn't run from his presence. Couldn't run from his arms. Jesus, he loves me, he loves me, he is for me. Jesus, how can it be? He loves me, he is for me. It was a fire deep in my soul, I'll never be the same. Stepped out of the dark and into the light when he called my name. I couldn't run from his presence. Couldn't run from his arms. Jesus, he loves me, he loves me, he is for me. Jesus, how can it be? He loves me, he is for me. He holds the stars and he holds my heart. Healing hands that bear the scars, the rugged cross where he died for me, my only hope, my everything. Jesus, He loves me, He loves me, He loves me. Jesus, how can it be? He loves me, He is for me.
On that night, Jesus took very simple elements. In the midst of a tremendous struggle as to whether they were going to follow the will of God or not, He took bread, He broke it for them and said, "This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After the dinner, He took the cup. He gave thanks to God. He gave it to His disciples and said, "Drink of this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins." In the United Methodist Church, all who want to come forward for Holy Communion are welcome to do so. We serve by intinction, which means I'll give you a piece of bread or someone else will, and you dip it into the cup and eat it, and then return to your seat for a time of silent prayer and reflection. And we have gluten-free elements, should you need it. Just make sure that you come down the aisle and show us that you're not going to take the bread that we're handing you. Will those who are coming forward to serve with me come forward? Purple. Will people who are not in seats in the back come forward first down the middle? And then we'll still come to the middle even though you have two sections. Oh. Thank you. Let's pray together. Gracious and loving God, we thank you for this table, for the forgiveness and opportunity that it represents, and for the chance to share your tables with people in this community, for the next couple of weeks that we can turn into this table. Help us, Lord, to be curious. Help us to be gracious. Help us to be loving. Otherwise, if you'll take your chair and help us break down the space. Go forth in peace. May the God who is peace go with you. Amen.
stretches to